Hello, I am Marianne Wolf, CEO of Wolf Ed and a consultant who helps the Alliance with its work in digital learning. Welcome and thank you for joining us. Today I am very excited to moderate what should be a very interesting and thought-provoking webinar about the future of teacher preparation in the digital age. As I prepared for this webinar, I realized that I have rarely been part of a discussion about digital learning, school reform, or ensuring that students are prepared for college and career, in which professional learning of teachers and teacher preparation have not quickly risen to an important piece of the conversation. As a former teacher, I appreciate the recognition of the critical role of educators, and the Alliance for Excellent Education has placed a specific emphasis on teachers in their digital learning work. In particular, the Alliance's recent report, Culture Shift: Teaching in a Learner-Centered Environment Powered by Technology, explores instruction that is rigorous and based on college and career-ready expectations, personalized, collaborative, relevant, and applied, and flexible, with learning taking place anytime and anywhere. The Culture Shift further outlines the role of the teacher in this learner-centered environment. Bob Wise, president of the Alliance and former governor of West Virginia, describes this role as an education designer, which includes the teacher as a facilitator of learning, a user of data and assessments, a collaborator, contributor, and coach with peers, and a curriculum adapter and designer. However, these new roles require relevant and ongoing support and professional learning opportunities that are job embedded, which are consistent with teacher preparation overall. Similarly, in a report the Alliance released in mid-November, "The Nation's Schools Are Stepping Up to Higher Standards," the Alliance points to the future of teaching as one of four major challenges facing the education system in the coming years. As the Alliance strives to encourage and support districts to maximize the potential of digital learning through comprehensive planning, the support and professional learning opportunities of teachers will be essential to a district's ability to meet the needs of students. Although the Culture Shift and Stepping Up reports certainly reference the importance of educators, professional learning opportunities, and teacher preparation, they also identify that in many states, districts, and schools across the country, we are not there yet. For many new teachers, this is particularly real as they face challenges of new college and career-ready or Common Core state standards, online assessments, and demands to personalize learning for increasingly diverse students. As always, I like to share that we do have some good news and that there are places around the country that are developing programs and opportunities for teacher candidates so that they can enter the workforce prepared to face the challenges ahead. We are also beginning to understand that teacher preparation must ensure that teachers have ongoing support to be effective and to stay in the profession. Today, we have the opportunity to explore these ideas and possibilities with three experts in the field. It is my pleasure to introduce to you Drs. Barnett Berry, Ron Thorpe, and Lynn Schrum. You will notice that each has a tie to digital learning or innovation in education to help us push our thinking. Here in the studio, I am happy to be joined by Barnett Berry. Barnett is the founder and president of the Center for Teaching Quality, based in Carrboro, North Carolina. CTQ seeks to dramatically improve student learning by advancing teaching as a 21st century, results-oriented profession. A former high school teacher, Dr. Berry has worked as a social scientist at the RAND Corporation, served as a senior executive with the South Carolina Department of Education, and directed an education policy center while he was a professor at the University of South Carolina. His new book, Teaching 2030, What We Must Do for Our Students in Our Public Schools, Now and in the Future, penned with 12 expert teachers from CTQ's Teachers Leaders Network, poses a provocative and hopeful future for the profession that makes all others possible. I'm also pleased to welcome Ron Thorpe, president of the National Board for Professional Teaching Standards. Ron began his teaching career at Phillips Academy in Andover, Massachusetts, where he also was assistant to the headmaster, the late Theodore R. Sizer, whom he credits with shaping his vision for schools. He has worked on the philanthropic side of the Geraldine R. Dodge Foundation, the Rhode Island Foundation, and at the Wallace Foundation. Before coming to the National Board, he was Vice President for Education at WNET, the nation's flagship public television station in New York City, where he is the architect of an event that will be familiar to many of you, the Celebration of Teaching and Learning, a world-class conference for K-12 educators. Joining us by phone is Lynne Schrum. Lynne is the Dean of the College of Human Resources and Education at West Virginia University. She is a former department chair at the University of Utah and the past president of the International Society for Technology and Education, where I had the pleasure of also working with her, and was the academic program coordinator for elementary education at George Mason University. She brings a wealth of knowledge on exemplary leadership, technology in the classroom, online education, and distance learning to her work at WVU. Thank you all for joining us. Below the video window, I just want to let you know there is a chat box where you can submit questions for our panelists, and we're very excited to already be receiving many questions from you from during the registration process and already today. We will turn to those questions from time to time during the next hour. I would like to turn to you, Ron, first. Through your work at the National Board, you helped to establish the standards for and recognize excellence in teaching. We are certainly interested in your perspective on how technology can help to strengthen teacher preparation and support. Would you please share with us your work in this area and how it affects your vision for the profession of teaching?
Well, Marianne, I'm happy to do that, and I want to thank you and Bob Wise and the Alliance for having this webinar today. These are so important as the profession grows, so thank you for that, and we're glad to be part of it. I want to step back a second from technology to talk about teacher preparation in general, because that's the context in which we have to understand this. So let's start with something that we all hear often, this notion that if there could be a time traveler from 100 years ago, and she or he came forward to Washington, where we are today, they wouldn't recognize very much of anything they saw except if they went into the public schools. So why is that? Why have schools not changed in the face of a backdrop where everything else has changed so dramatically, especially because of technology? I refuse to believe that it's because teachers sit back and say, we don't want to change. We want to stay the same forever. I don't know a single teacher who feels that way. So you then have to ask yourself the question, why don't we change in teaching more? And to me, my conclusion is it has to do with the 15,000 hours that every person, teacher or non-teacher, has spent as a student in a classroom before they even get to become a teacher. Any behavioral scientist will tell you that 15,000 hours is an enormous amount of imprinting. And whether it's good, bad, or indifferent, it doesn't matter. It is what is sort of built into our DNA as we go forward. And I think with teaching especially, it's very hard to teach in ways that you haven't learned yourself. Because this teaching and learning, they're inextricably bound. And they're the opposites, they complement each other. And if you haven't learned in a certain way, you can't imagine how to teach in that way. So I think teacher preparation programs everywhere face a challenge that no other profession changes. And it's tied to this 15,000 hour imprinting that we've all had. So the question then becomes, what can we do? What can teacher preparations do to start providing a flywheel to those 15,000 hours? And this is a place where the National Board is ready to step up and help teacher preparation programs everywhere. And that's through using the videos and reflective papers that are submitted by teachers who successfully achieve board certification. We have thousands of these. From last year alone, and only from teachers who successfully certified and hit the cut score on those entries, we have over 10,000 of these videos and reflective papers. These are 15-minute videos that show how accomplished teachers work in a classroom, but just as important are the reflective papers, which identify how accomplished teachers think. And I believe that if we could immerse undergraduates, pre-service candidates, in a world where they're looking at multiple examples of what accomplished teachers look like and how they think, then we could start to make major inroads into changing the process that we employ with our students today. And sometimes that will include technology and sometimes it won't. But I think that's a major contribution that the National Board is about to make. And we're very fortunate to announce that we received an I-3 grant in the most recent round for the development projects. And we'll be working with Linda Darling Hammond, Deborah Ball, Sharon Robinson, and the teacher, what's called EdTPA, the Teacher Preparation Assessment Project, where we will be putting our video and reflective paper assets into teacher preparation and induction programs in three sites around the country.
That's great, Ron. And it's just fascinating, as people always tell us at the Alliance, how much they want to see what it looks like and show us what you're talking about. And so to be able to do that, I think, is just is fascinating.
Well, and I think on top of that is, because we have so many videos, we avoid the problem of suggesting that there's only one good way to teach something. Literally, out of 10,000 videos, I probably have four examples of how middle school science teachers do plate tectonics. And one might be from an urban setting, one might be a rural setting. Who knows where they've come from? But the fact is, as every teacher knows, there is no one best way to teach anything.
And I'm wondering, Ron, if you're seeing, recognizing that there's many different instructional strategies to use, are you overall seeing an increase in the use of digital learning in the examples and the video models that are being sent to you?
I think so. I'm not sure about that. I'd like to believe it. I think accomplished teachers are people who know how to use technology for its unique affordances, mm-hmm. not just to use it as an expensive blackboard, you know, as we so often do. We take the next generation technology and we use it in the same way we use the previous generation technology. We all are victims of that, I think. So it is an opportunity. But I think there are other places where you can go to see pretty interesting examples, such as the Teaching Channel. And I'm happy to put in a plug for them right now, too, because they're actively out there looking for those kinds of examples.
Great. Well, thank you very much. And we certainly want, you know, when the Alliance looks at digital learning, it certainly is to see how does it help us to meet the needs of kids that we're having a hard time meeting. And I think that's exactly what we're all talking about today. Barnett, through your work with Teaching 2030, you provided a look at what teaching will or should look like in the future, which certainly emphasized the importance and the need of teacher preparation programs to help us get there. I had the pleasure of working with your organization on an upcoming release about the future of teacher preparation, and I wonder if you could share with us your vision for what is needed and also what is possible.
Thank you so much, Marianne, and it's great to be here as well, and I can't tell you how thrilled I am that Ron is here in Washington with his vision and leadership, because it is a much needed breath of fresh air. Because here in this town, when you talk about improving teacher preparation, it seems like the debate is at best is going to just keep us in the late 20th century at best. We know debating whether or not we should have input-based accreditation versus value-added statistics to judge teacher ed programs, or debating between whether it should be done in alternative certification programs versus year-long internships, and then whether or not we should have research-based teacher ed versus how to implement someone else's curriculum, teacher education. So instead of kind of getting in the middle of that debate, the teachers in our network, not just the 12 who helped me put together Teaching 2030, but 17 teachers of the 2,000 in our virtual community took that book that was published about a year and a half ago and started thinking about what the future of teacher ed must look like. And so these 17 teachers, and if you look at this infographic, was maybe on the screen with me right now, it will be released in mid-January, and this infographic takes a look at what we call Teacher Prep 2.0 with a peering and glance and a hard look, perhaps even, to 3.0, so that we can get beyond the debates that seem to kind of keep us handcuffed here in Washington, D.C., and get to where we need to be for not just tomorrow, but 2030 and beyond. So what I'd love to do is just kind of take you into the middle of this document by first jumping into a couple of the teaching profession components that need to undergird the new system of teacher preparation that is needed. First and foremost, and I will just hit a couple of the high points here, is that we need to have a teacher ed system that fuses the resources of both universities and school districts. And if we get lucky, we'll end up putting community-based organizations in there. So instead of siloing those different entities, we need to put them together to fuel the kind of seamless preparation, induction, and support of lifelong teachers. That's number one. We also need to think very differently about preparing teacher leaders. I think we're going to need lots of generalists and specialists in the years ahead, and we're going to need learning architects and teacherpreneurs in particular to help manage the wide variety of resources that children are going to need and deserve as they tackle 21st century skills and the global marketplace. The teacher preparation program components in particular, I think, can draw upon most notably cohort-based residencies, community-based internships, blended learning and virtual networks. So what Ron is doing with Stanford is absolutely, and AACT is spot on. Can think about a network of board-certified teachers mentoring teachers in training in virtual community so that those new teachers can have access not to just to the reflective papers and the video lessons themselves, or the digitally recorded lessons. Video just kind of describes my age here a little bit, but also begin to connect them in powerful ways. And we can get away from this competency-based teacher ed and move toward performance-based teacher ed, which AACT works. AACT and their EdTPA is groundbreaking there. And then we can imagine to build upon some of the fabulous programs that actually are in place right now. They're promising programs. There is a myth that every teacher ed program out there is not doing what it needs to be doing. We think that's absolutely wrong. We found, as you know, with those 17 teachers, lots of terrific examples, including West Virginia University and the University of Central Florida working together. So those teachers in training actually get to know each other, and they're working with augmented reality and virtual learning tools to learn how to teach in contexts that they wouldn't be able to interact with otherwise. We know the Academy for Urban School Leadership is providing a powerful model for how to build internships for career teachers. We know Abilene Christian University is already developing virtual lesson study for its soon-to-be teachers. And then Stanford University, I think, is one of many research centers that are very good at preparing teachers as researchers, much the way you find teachers in Finland and in Singapore. And then finally, let's take a look at a Teacher Prep 3.0. And we need to get there well before the year 2030. But think about how virtual reality and holographics and playlists and MOOCs can help totally change the way teachers are prepared and way they can work with children. Think about new roles for teachers. And I think universities and research centers can play a powerful role in preparing the kinds of teachers and teacher leaders, who we call learning architects and teacherpreneurs. So imagine this, and this is the last slide, and then I'd love for you to think about teacher leaders that are being prepared in the future as information interrogators, as surgical student learning brokers, as virtual professional learning community organizers, as edugame developers, and as boundary spanners for policy and pedagogical transformation. These are the roles for teachers in the future. And come mid-January, there will be a website at www.teachingquality.org, where you can click onto this infographic and find examples and promising practices and big vision from some of our nation's best teachers.
Thank you, Barnett. And I think it's really exciting to hear what's already happening, but also exciting to think far into the future, but hopefully not too far into the future of what's possible. We received some questions ahead of time, and I'd like to pose this to you, Barnett, but also to you, Ron, about important policy and certification changes that need to happen for teacher preparation. And as we talk about this vision that you both have and possibilities, I'm wondering if you would both like to comment, maybe Barnett first and then Ron, about some specific policies that would really help us to move or progress more quickly to making this a reality.
I think for me, the first policy change would be to actually promote the spread of teaching expertise, Marianne, through teacher leadership, that we actually value teachers spreading their expertise to each other in and out of cyberspace. If we had policy framework and incentives to do that, that would take us a long way toward universities and other education preparation providers to actually building the supply of those teachers.
Thank you.
So I would respond to that by bringing up what Barnett and I learned when we traveled together to Helsinki back in August to look at the Finnish system. There, the teacher preparation program is so rigorous. Only 1 in 10 people who want to become a teacher get admitted into those programs. It's very selective. But beyond that, it is 4 years of undergraduate and then the master's degree. And the master's degree is very serious business. It is a blend of a pure research degree where primary school teachers have to do their master's paper in child development, and secondary school teachers or candidates to become secondary school teachers have to do a research paper in their content area. So, I mean, nobody gets into a classroom without that. So I would strongly advocate for policy in the United States to change so that the master's degrees that we expect teachers to get eventually get moved forward, that they happen before they even set foot in a classroom, and that they become the serious master's program that we saw in Finland.
Great.
Could I just jump in and add one more thing to add to these excellent suggestions?
Of course.
Thank you. And that is, in education, professional development is often whatever is available on Tuesday, and it's frequently sort of denigrated. And I would like to see very, very purposeful professional development organized, just as we ask teachers to think of goals for the coming year, that their professional development be tied to what they teach, what they need expertise in, what they need revision in, rather than a haphazard, which I think would also raise our professional standards.
Yeah, Lynn, in Finland, not only do they prepare teachers, as Ron suggested, as researchers, and of course then the policymakers trust them because of their knowledge base, but then they have time actually to spread their expertise. Actually, what's interesting in Finland, K-12 teachers are treated much like the way we treat our university professors here in America.
In terms of their autonomy.
Absolutely.
So in the two international summits on the teaching profession that we've done the last 2 years, this was my big takeaway, and Barnett already mentioned it, this idea of teacher as researcher. All of the high-performing countries train their teachers to be researchers. And when I first heard that, I didn't quite know what to make of it. But then I started to realize that as a teacher, everything I do in class is a mini research project. I have an idea. I'm trying to see what kind of impact I have on my students by introducing some variable into the mix. Mm-hmm. And then I'm trying to figure out whether it worked or not and why. So everything a teacher does at one level or another is a research project. But I don't think today most of our teacher preparation programs in the States are preparing people to be researchers.
And
I don't want people to think that this means you're going to now work for AIR or some big research firm or RAND and to do that kind of research. It's research in the classroom.
Well, you know, unfortunately, we prepare so many teachers that we don't need for jobs that don't exist in subject areas and fields that are where there's no shortage, okay? If we actually could manage the so-called teacher education labor market and then fuse those resources of K-12 systems and universities and hopefully one day community-based organizations, Marianne, we can afford easily to do the kind of teacher preparation that Ron and Lynn are talking about.
And I think we're definitely hearing how much rethinking of the purpose and what's possible for teacher preparation that keeps coming through in these discussions. And it really does take a step back and thinking about how do we make sure we're meeting the needs of the teachers, but also meeting the needs of the students and the schools. And I think there are many different pieces here that we need to consider. And I do want to hear a little bit more from you, Lynn, because you are really on the ground right now in one of those teacher preparation programs. And I know, you know, I've long followed your work on digital learning and also leadership. It's curious to me to hear how you're bringing all this different experience and research to your new role, because you really are kind of entering a different type of approach, I think, to teacher preparation in a new place. And so building upon all these wonderful comments about policy and what teacher prep can look like, and I really appreciate your thoughts on professional development and the fact that it can't be the two-hour workshop and expect us to really change and affect practice. So I would love to hear from you on, you know, how you're taking all this wealth of experience you have to your new role as dean in West Virginia.
Thank you, Marianne, and thank you, Ron and Barnett, because you've really set me up very nicely. I like it. Well, let me start by saying that, yes, I've been studying this for a very long time, and one of the things I've learned, similar to what Ron said, educators want to teach children. They are not our students. They're not there simply to mark time, and we all know of all of the excellent teachers who are around, but I began thinking very strongly of what were the stale sort of blocks keeping people from changing their practice. And I think Ron's point about the hours we've spent being taught in old ways is certainly part of it. But I've also found out that overwhelmingly we need strong leaders in the schools, and our leaders are not always prepared to lead 21st century schools. So a colleague and I, Barbara Levin, spent about a year going to different places where leaders had been identified as making a difference in student achievement, which is, after all, what we are all about. And one of the leverage points was technology, but by no means the total leverage point. And what we found after about 150 interviews with teachers and school leaders and about 300 hours of observing really excellent practice was that it really takes teachers being prepared to be leaders in multiple ways and also having an educational environment in which they were valued, their views were respected, they had the opportunity to try things. I think those were the kinds of things that we took away, that these were places where time was given, and that's, I know, one of the big things in the Scandinavian countries, where teachers actually have time to talk to each other, to plan. It's not the 3 minutes between periods, or if you happen to run into somebody in the lunchroom, but really focused time where we can talk about lessons, we can talk about learners and their needs. Another thing we saw substantially was a use of data in so many different ways, building on data, extracting those data, analyzing it, rethinking it, and then redesigning their lessons based on what those data say. We found a lot of reflection going on verbally, academically, in multiple ways, where people were able to talk about their practice. Again, not the egg carton where, you know, I close my door and I do this alone, but this real professional community. And then lots of creativity, which, if you go to the next slide, really meant that we value risk-taking, we value people to try new ways of teaching and learning and then to reflect on it. Some of that requires residency programs, and I know we have this national conversation about what are the right ways to prepare educators. I confess that having been a teacher educator now for 20-something years, I believe that there are values instilled in the ways that we've been doing things, not to say it's perfect, but we can move forward from that. I think the idea of teams, none of us work alone these days, and yet we often ask teachers to try and do that. So again, some of those things I've taken away that I think are really important. I think preparing educators to be part of teams, but also being part of leadership, where leadership is valued. We saw models of distributed leadership where school leaders, whether that's a principal or a superintendent, recognize that they are not the one horse pulling the cart, that this is a team effort. And those were some of the kinds of things. I'd also like to mention the notion of teacher as researcher. More and more we are seeing schools where I know this one, West Virginia University, our educators all do a capstone research project. The place I came from, George Mason, every educator leaving that program does an action research project where it's rigorous research. What we don't always see is that that's valued in the schools when they get there, and they aren't given the time and energy and encouragement to continue that. However, I would like to say that I've been talking, I don't know a good educator who is not, at least in their head, doing research all the time, saying, that didn't work with that student. What do I have to try to do next? So I think we have the pieces of the puzzle. We just need to try and articulate how they fit together better and make it more visible.
Thank you, Lynne. I think Barnett wants to ask a question. Sure.
You know, we cannot just kind of slam and smush all those components of time, use of data, lots of reflection, lots of creativity, research-based adaptive pedagogy. These are the kinds of things that Lynne sees in excellent teaching and what excellent teachers do. We need to do that for prospective teachers in their preparation programs. But you can't do it in a four-year program where you're also learning or meeting your general education requirements, right? So we got to think much more broadly about the future of teacher ed, much more seamlessly in terms of what gets done before you become an independent teacher of record, what gets done in those first few years of initial teaching when you're most likely not having a full load, like you find in many of the high-performing nations, but your induction into the profession is staged, and then finally scaffolding, board certification, and beyond.
So may I just mention New Zealand? I happen to be there in the spring, and they have a model that I just fell in love with. When someone graduates from a teacher preparation program, they get a sort of a practice license, and for 2 years, they teach 80% of a full load, not a full load, and during the other 20%, they observe good teachers, so they continue their practice learning. They have mentors. They do all kinds of things, and during those 2 years, they put together a portfolio of student learning outcomes, which we're all about, and so forth, and then at the end of those 2 years, they submit that to the government, and they are hopefully then granted a full license. And it's the school's responsibility to help them with the university, but also the school's responsibility, which I think, again, it's partnership, so that we're all involved, that we all have a stake in making sure that the classroom teacher is the best classroom teacher.
I'd like to follow up on that. Please. Because I was very, very lucky in 1974 when I graduated from college and went to teach. As you mentioned, it was at a very fine independent school, Phillips Academy in Andover, and it was run by Ted Sizer. I mean, it was a wonderful opportunity for any new teacher. But at that school, and I'm sure that's still this way today, if you have no teaching experience, you may only start as a teaching fellow, and that means you teach only two courses. Mm-hmm. So there I was for a whole year teaching only two courses with all the rest of the day, and it was a boarding school, so the day was 24 hours long. So with all the rest of the day to sit in on other classes and to prepare my classes, not making compromises, and Ted's old title, Horace's Compromise, but starting out in an ideal state. And after that first year of getting my sea legs in terms of my students, then I was ready to take on a full-time load. I've often thought that if there was one single thing I could do to change the quality of instruction in schools and the careers of teachers, and I don't know how I'd do this for elementary school teachers where you're kind of a generalist all day long, but there's got to be a workaround for it. I would say all new teachers come into the field teaching a half load.
Yeah, and thanks to Bob Wise's leadership and the Alliance, you know, this organization has made a lot of the enormous cost of teacher turnover. We're talking about in the billions of dollars it costs this country. So if we didn't lose teachers like we do today, we could begin to afford to do what Ron and Lynn are describing. What Ron's described, what he had at Andover, and what Lynn described and what she saw in New Zealand.
Yeah. I would love for the NEA and the AFT to start advocating for this. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If they want to really sort of allow those first-year teachers, where the turnover, as Barnett said, is so high. Richard Ingersoll's research out of Pennsylvania right now shows that the modal amount of time a teacher is in the classroom today, in other words, if you looked at all 3. Whatever million teachers, there are more first-year teachers than any other group.
So a question I have for you is, when you think about this, I'm hearing different possibilities for where the leadership to make this happen can come from. It's obviously people like all three of you, but it also takes partnerships with districts, and it takes, you know, an agreement that are working together with teacher preparation programs, alternative or college-based, right, moving into districts who are then going to make that happen. And it's interesting because I was going to ask a question about how do we help, like, use digital learning to help make those connections stronger. But I think we should even look a little more broadly at this question to see, where do you think, how do you think we influence this the most? I mean, I think you've given some good ideas with NEA, AFT, obviously organizations like your all's and the Alliance. What other things?
There are two places, things that I would say to that. First of all, in terms of school leadership, I am very interested in doing some research around the phenomenon of national board certified teachers now becoming principals of schools. Mm-hmm. In your state alone, in North Carolina, there are 181 schools that are run by principals who are national board certified teachers. And I suspect, my hypothesis is that these school leaders have a very different vision, expectations for their teachers, ideas of supporting their teachers, how their school climate should be run, because the experience of becoming a board certified teacher is so powerful that I can't imagine that they suddenly forget all that when they become a principal. And so I would think that that's an interesting topic to look at.
Yes.
I'll stop there so Barnett can jump in.
Well, I would say that actually, if we had more opportunities for administrators to teach, more teachers could lead. And this is actually, go back to Finland, Ron.
Yes. Or the
unless it was the largest school. I mean, for them, large school would be about 1,000 kids. But the any school under 1,000, the principal and the assistant principal all teach. Mm-hmm. And that's what frees up more time for teachers to lead in a variety of ways. And the teachers working with kids, they're using the technology, but we're not backward mapping it into our programs like we could. Mm-hmm. So if we gave teachers a little bit more time to innovate, gave them incentives to be teacherpreneurial mm-hmm. without leaving the classroom, I think we can build demand for what kids of today and tomorrow really deserve in terms of their public education.
In American independent schools, all administrators teach. Yeah. Ted Sizer taught while he was the head of Phillips Academy. When I was a dean of faculty at the Kingswood Oxford School in West Hartford, Connecticut, and chief academic officer, I taught. And I know it kept me from making some really bad policies because I was going to have to follow them too. Mm-hmm. So you never, when you're in that kind of a situation, you never are very far from the reality of a classroom. But we've had a hard time figuring that out in our structure.
We have. Lynn, do you want to respond to that?
She may have been lost in that crash.
Oh, okay. Well, we will keep on, we will continue, and hopefully Lynn will be joining us again. I do want to turn now to a couple of questions we've actually received from participants. And one is from Vicki in Oregon, who asked about how can teacher preparation programs make sure that teachers that are currently being trained or candidates are prepared for the Common Core state standards. And I think this is a question, whether it's Common Core or college and career ready, we know this affects almost every state in this country. And so I'd love to have Ron and Barnett share with us their thoughts on this, because clearly it's in the minds of many educators, leaders, administrators, and teacher prep programs around the country.
All right. Ron, you want to go first?
Yeah, I think I will. First of all, there are a couple organizations like Sharon Robinson's AACTE. I think they need to step up and help teacher preparation programs make sure that they are seriously aligned to the Common Core and that they don't fall victim to what a lot of teachers are likely to fall victim to, which is, oh, I already know how to do that. It's just, I just have to change the language a little bit. There's fundamentally nothing different about this. That's a fallacy. I also think that teacher preparation programs, and this is something the National Board is working very hard on right now, we need in this profession to build a coherent trajectory from teacher preparation through to being accomplished. And I think there are too few teacher preparation programs that have looked seriously at the profession's standards as they are embodied in National Board and have backmapped that down to their preparation programs. Now, when the National Board started its standards, there weren't any, the Common Core didn't exist. But the early standards committees were wise enough to say that accomplished teachers know how to teach to high and worthy standards. So now they are the high and worthy standards that we're talking about. And just as luck would have it, we were revising our math standards and our ELA standards after the Common Core came into being. So if you look at the standards for ELA and math and National Board right now, they include Common Core in there.
Very helpful.
So I got a quick answer to that question. I think Ron's going to love it too. So amongst the 2,000 teachers in our virtual community, this past year or so, we've had about 24 board certified teachers funded by the Gates Foundation to work on implementing the Common Core and new assessments in what might be called a virtual Japanese lesson study community. Well, I can easily see adding at least a zero, maybe two zeros to that number. So that's 2,400 MBCTs. We could easily find them. And what if teacher ed programs, to stay in business, they had to have those 2,400 MBCTs, both in face-to-face and virtual community, to be professors of education while still teaching. And those MBCTs help future teachers learn to teach to the Common Core.
And along with that, I think we could be more conscious about student teacher placements. Mm-hmm. Who are the teachers who are supervising these candidates? We know from story after story that it's very haphazard of how those people are assigned. I've also heard from teachers who say it makes a big difference whether a student teacher comes into my class in the first semester of the year when I'm establishing my relationship with students and I'm building the culture of my classroom, as opposed when they come in the second semester, where sadly so many schools have stopped important teaching and are just preparing people for the exams.
Yeah.
And that you're cheating a student teacher out of an experience if that's all you've given them.
Of course. Lynn, do you want to jump in here?
Well, I'd just like to say that to me, my experience is that teacher candidates need that full year. The most successful teachers we've found, and we have data to support this from my work at George Mason University, when teachers have a whole year so they see the entire span and have the opportunity to grow into being a teacher, that's perhaps the best. Where I am now at West Virginia, our flagship program, it's a five-year program, and the candidates spend 3 years in scaffolded experiences learning, and finally their last year, but they're in one school, our professional development schools, where we've established strong relationships with the schools, with the teachers, and a candidate spends 3 years there. Well, so no longer do you have somebody who, and I have experienced this, where someone is in their final semester and they suddenly go, oh, is that what teaching's about? I'm not interested. So they're really prepared in multiple ways and they get to try things out. But again, that takes a trust and relationship that the classroom teacher knows that she or he can trust that candidate to do a good job. Because after all, those children are entrusted to them. So there are lots of different models. I love the idea of professors still taking some time to be back into the schools or keeping up their professional standard documentation.
Or K-12 teachers, MBCTs, and other accomplished teachers of that ilk who actually have both the status as well as the time to be professors of education. And what if we, as I talked about earlier in very brief words, have these fused resources that put together the K-12 and higher ed system so it's affordable, Lynn, for you to do that work with local school districts, both near and far, by the way. This thing called internet.
And I couldn't agree more. I think there is nothing better than seconding a teacher out of a classroom, a good teacher, to help inform the people at the university to do it so that it's a win-win. That's what we expect from our teacher candidates, to learn and teach each other. Why are we not doing that at the post-secondary level? I totally agree with you.
Well, this is an aspect of EdTPA that I think is especially strong and promising. This idea that teacher preparation programs are not just washing their hands of their candidates when they graduate, but they are staying in contact with them in the first, second year of induction and working with districts consciously. So that there's a feedback loop back to programs like LynnE's, so your candidates aren't doing very well with the Common Core, whatever happens to be.
In the future of teacher ed, we need to start preparing actually many more types of generalists, like the learning architect and the teacherpreneur, and the specialist in teaching fractions to 10-year-olds, as well as the specialist who works as a community liaison between the museum, the library, the social service agency, and what was once called a K-12 school. We need a wide variety of specialists and generalists, and we need to get out of this kind of one-size-fits-all teacher education model.
Thank you.
Well, and go ahead, Lynn.
Oh, I was just going to add one thing, and that's, you know, one of the strongest models of teacher preparation is the cohort model. And then when they really need it the most, when they're starting in their own classroom, we abandon that model and they're all on their own, which is insane.
So I would, you know, one of the things that's really fascinating to me right now is how much we're talking about different roles that we should be preparing teachers for. And each one of you has mentioned that in many different ways. And yet when we think to some of, I mean, my own teacher prep, I don't know that that was part of it. One thing, a question that came in from Ferdy in New Mexico was this notion of we are in a new time where we have to be preparing teachers to teach in a blended learning environment, potentially in an online learning environment, as well as in the face-to-face. And you know, what role could student teachers be playing if they had a strong background in blended learning? What could they be doing in their schools to also be helping veteran teachers as they progress in some of that? So I wonder if you all, you could each comment a little bit on what we need to be doing in teacher prep to making sure that teachers are prepared for all of those learning environments and how we can do that most effectively. And Ron, I'm going to let you start, and then Barnett,
I'm going to go back to what I said in my opening remarks. We often teach the way we were taught. So if the first step in teacher preparation programs is making sure that all of those undergraduates or whatever level they are who are in teacher preparation programs, that part of their learning must be through that blended learning themselves, so they then know how to flip the paradigm when they get into classrooms.
I think to be a career teacher, and then if you commit to being a career teacher, you'll be paid more up front, and then like Finland and Singapore, you ought to have your education paid for. I think there ought to be an internship in a community-based organization inside of a real neighborhood where children live 24/7 and their parents live 24/7, but I think there also ought to be a virtual internship where they're working with other teachers around the world, around the country, around the state, but also with students as well. And we've got to do it. We have teachers doing this right now, Marianne. We just don't have a system of policy and practice to scale it up.
I think it's an opportunity for teachers also to look beyond the walls of the school, as Barnett was suggesting. We've got science centers in this country who are providing amazing learning environments.
The Exploratorium. The Exploratorium in San Francisco is a great example.
I'd like to talk about the New York Hall of Science.
Okay, that's right.
But no, absolutely they are. There's Lawrence Hall and all these Pittsburgh Children's Museum.
Inside joke here. Ron has to fess up later about that.
May I add to that? Because I think it's a wonderful question, and I may not make myself very popular by my answer, but it seems to me that faculty in colleges of education need to model these things in ways that we may not always be doing it. Again, the notion that we teach the way we were taught, but we have to have professors who are willing and able and comfortable in modeling these types of blended experiences, in facilitating, in supervising. We could do a lot with supervision in different ways using the technology that's available to us. There's no reason to be doing it the way we've always done it. So I will take responsibility for helping faculty members change, because after all, that's where it's really got to start too.
Yeah, I might be a little bit more radical on this front, Lynn, if you don't mind. I think some of the nation's most accomplished teachers, and we're getting ready to profile 8 of them in a new book entitled Teacherpreneurs, How Innovative Teachers Lead But Don't Leave. I would say that our best teachers ought to be the primary, if will, providers of teacher education, and those who are currently professors of education should play a supportive role, helping around research, inquiry, and making sure there's connections between theory and practice. But the primary deliverer, if you will, the nexus of the program ought to be in our most accomplished teachers who are serving these hybrid roles, teaching children as well as preparing a next generation of teachers.
So well, if we're really looking at student achievement here, if that's our ultimate goal, we have some very powerful examples in the teaching force right now that tend to be on the outskirts of what we usually think about, but they have a lot to teach us. And there are two groups. The one is special ed teachers. As I talk to special education teachers around this country, they are more insightful about individual students and their needs. That's how they've been brought into this field. Also, I think it's very interesting that special ed teachers are the only teachers in school who didn't spend 15,000 hours in special ed classes. They don't come to this with all that imprinting of, I was a student in a special ed class. They, by definition, they probably weren't in those classes. So I think there's a lot we can learn from special ed classes. Teachers. The other group, of course, are those people who are coaches of athletics, music directors, drama teachers, all those who are naturally, their student work is naturally connected to performance. I had a chance last week in Palo Alto High School to sit in on the journalism class taught by Esther Wojcicki, who is a National Board Certified Teacher and renewed, I'm glad to say. This was a class with more than 80 students in it. And they got to work before she even arrived. They were working on a student newspaper, 3 different publication, magazine publications. These kids knew what they were doing. She was just there as a coach, really, as they were doing performance. And we need to figure out how to pull some of that authentic work into our other classes.
But may I add that this is where policy comes in, because a higher ed accreditation body just recently made George Mason University give up many of our expert educators who we hired to help teach the pre-service teachers. They made them give them up because they don't have PhDs. So here's a place where the rubber doesn't meet the road, and where the policy required that the best teachers no longer be able to teach our pre-service teachers. Now, talk about tragedy. That really was one.
You're exactly right, Lynn. Thanks for adding that to the mix. And that's, you know, that's fixable. That is fixable.
No, I definitely think what we're hearing here is there are practical pieces to this, and there's that the potential is almost easiest to see in some of those examples. And then there's very, very significant policy changes, but they're doable. And I think it's figuring out what are those key policy changes and helping make them happen that can perhaps open doors.
So here's where I think the profession, we've been talking about policy, and that's government. But in professions, practitioners in the field, they create the key definitions of what happens and what goes forward. And if they do it really, really well, the way they have in medicine, law, and the other iconic professions, then government policy kind of aligns to it, because governments sit back and say, well, geez, doctors know how to do this. We might as well just use their test instead of ours. But our profession has been profoundly silent on this. And therefore, we often are faced with policy that well-meaning people have created, but they're uninformed. But they've done it because they've moved into a void that we've created.
Do you think with so much more digital learning coming down the pike, and with the need for common core state standards and meeting those things and need to teach differently, and there are a lot of things coming that are helping us push that direction, does that give us a really exciting opening right now in terms of some of that, those stagnant policies or things that need to be changed, and maybe the profession saying, in order to do this, we really have to make things different?
I see plenty of examples of the profession stepping up right now. A week ago Monday, Randy Weingarten and the AFT announced that they believe that there should be a bar-like exam for education. NEA is about to make a very big announcement that Barnett and I are both involved in. This is the profession stepping up. And the phrase that we use at the National Board is that teachers must become the agents of reform, not the targets of it. And when we make that transition, we make that pivot, things will be profoundly different.
But in doing so, we've got to change a prominent mindset in this country, where in the past, 3.2 million teachers, all treated alike, sat at the bottom and continue to sit at the bottom of the organizational pyramid. One of my favorite lines in our book, Teaching 2030, is it's time to blur the lines of distinction between those who teach in schools and those who lead them. We have to embrace that notion if we're going to get to where we need, and prepare teachers for the roles they must play in the years ahead.
Thank you very much. And we're getting many very good questions, and a couple are very, very practical. So I'm just going to ask a couple of those before we wrap up. I think we could go on for hours with these phenomenal guests that we have here, and very, very thoughtful questions. I have many more. One of the questions that's a practical one, Ron, is these videos that you talk about. Will you be making those available for people all over the country, or what's the access point for that?
Okay, that's a very good question, and we don't know the answer to it yet. What I know is that they will not be popping up on YouTube, because we need to protect the privacy of the children who are in these classes, as well as the teachers. Now, these are only teachers who have achieved, so no one is being held up as an example of less than accomplished teaching.
Right.
But our intention is to put these in a searchable database, digital database, and make it available through licensing arrangements to teacher preparation programs, school districts, anybody who needs access to these things, even to researchers who want to study what accomplished teaching is all about. So over the next 12 months, we'll have some answers to that question.
Excellent. And Barnett, Elizabeth asked whether the Teaching 2030 information is readily available online as well, so I just want to be able to share with folks who are curious.
If you go to our homepage, www.teachingquality.org, there's a buku materials around Teaching 2030, and in mid-January, the Teacher Prep 2.0 with a Peer Toward 3.0 will be up and live, where resources and ideas and most importantly, the voices of 17 of the nation's finest teachers are putting out their own ideas about what teacher ed ought to look like.
Excellent. And Lynn, the last question I want to ask you comes from Krista, who asks us whether we see virtual classrooms and simulated teaching experiences becoming a regular part of teacher preparation programs. And I think you have a little insight into this already. So I just, before we wrap up, I wanted to give you a chance to, I know you mentioned it earlier, but maybe just to talk a little bit about where you see that heading.
Absolutely. It's been so successful with our pre-service teachers who actually get to role play with real live people, avatars, but actors playing the parts. So they don't walk into the classroom cold. They've got this experience. They see how they might respond to a particular circumstance. And we see it being very successful. It needs to come down in cost. It needs to be more readily available to everybody. And what I'd like to see is it so organized that somebody could do it at home to practice before they go in for a day of teaching. So I see it moving in great directions.
Thank you, Lynn. And clearly many of your worlds coming together as you talk about that. So I appreciate that, too. As much as we could go on forever, I think it is time to thank you, Barnett, Ron, and Lynn, for your thoughtful comments and excellent recommendations. While we certainly have a lot of work ahead of us to ensure that teacher prep programs meet the needs of education systems, teachers, and ultimately our students, I'm encouraged to have people like you in the forefront of this work. I think we are also encouraged about what is possible. I'd also like to thank you, the participants, for being a part of this thought-provoking webinar. The webinar will be archived and available in the next day or two at allfored.org/webinars, and we encourage you to share it with your colleagues. We will also have a part two of the Future of Teacher Preparation series in the spring. Finally, we hope that you will celebrate Digital Learning Day with us on February 6, 2013. We are less than 2 months away. As we talk about the importance of preparing teachers for a learner-centered environment and for the roles that they will have in the future, Digital Learning Day provides a wonderful opportunity to learn from each other and also to celebrate the work of teachers across the country and the world. You can learn more about Digital Learning Day and sign up to participate at digitallearningday.org. You will get great information once you do that. So thank you very much for joining us and have a great day.